You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch. You really are a heel. You're as cuddly as a cactus. You're as charming as an eel, Mr. Grinch.
Have you learned those first few words of the Grinch song yet?
I have.
Sometimes I think I'm singing them in my sleep, too. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your presence with us. Lord, thank you for Emmanuel, Lord God, with us. Lord, thank you for the mystery of the incarnation as you became man and dwelt among us. And Father, we thank you for the glory that shone all around the shepherds. But Father, we also thank you for the glory of your Son, Christ Jesus, that shines within our own hearts, illuminating our own minds and spirits that we might know you. Father, we truly ask that in this day and in this hour, and Father, in this Christmas season, Lord, that you would indeed allow us to catch a glimpse of your glory, or the glory of the only begotten, full of grace and truth, or that that Christ might truly shine within our hearts. We pray in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. There's an old wives' tale that says that all babies are born with blue eyes. That's true if you're Caucasian. Not true if someone is born of a Latin descent or Asian or either a Native American or African American. That's not true. Their eyes are dark. So it's not true that all babies are born with blue eyes. But it's true that eyes are set, the color of the eyes are set somewhere between the third and the sixth month, and the eyes do not change colors throughout our life. Now, that being said, toward the end of our life, as we get older, sometimes our brown eyes will become more brown, or maybe our hazel eyes will darken a little bit. But by and large, our eye colors do not change. There were two professors at Cornell University who wrote a research paper entitled Reading What the Mind Thinks from How the Eye Sees. Reading What the Mind Thinks from How the Eye Sees. What they did was they took images of just the eyes of individuals, showed them to their test panel, and gave them 50 words to choose from to describe what their eyes were conveying. And in every case, people were able to connect a word with what the eyes seemed to be conveying. Kind of falls in line with what Jesus said, the eye is the lamp of the body, and if your eyes are healthy, then your whole body will be full of light. For most of us, most of us are not college professors, but for most of us, we didn't need a research paper to know that, did we? Because our mama or our daddy could give us the stink eye from across a football field, and we would know what that meant. Did not need words. Just look at the eyes, and you knew what the message was. You know, for most of us, if looks could kill, most of us as guys probably at least, probably would not have lived past the age of about 14 or 15. But there was the announcement of the angels to the shepherds, and the shepherds' response was, let us go see this thing. Let's go see this thing that has happened to us. So they went to Bethlehem and found the baby just as the angels had told them that they would find. And then we read in verse 17 that when they had seen him, I was interested, were those two different words there? Let us go see this thing that the Lord has done, or that the angels have described, and when they had seen. And it's the same words. But seeing a thing versus seeing him, two very different things. So here's the question that I pondered, and Tina picked up on and followed along with that very effectively. Does God open our hearts to see and to know him, or does knowing him open our hearts and our minds? Does God open our hearts to be able to see, to perceive Jesus to perceive the image of God, or does knowing him open our eyes? It's not a trick question. It is sort of that idea of which came first, the chicken or the egg. But we do know that with the shepherds, that when they saw him, they understood something that they had not understood just by being told that there was a child, a Messiah that had been born for them. We've been walking through the story, that iconic children's book, How the Grinch Stole Christmas. And here, as we're closing out the series, we see the Grinch at the end of the story. He has stolen the trees, the stockings, the gifts, and because he thought that he could prevent Christmas from coming. And he simply stood back at the top of the hill and waited to see, knowing that their mouths would drop open for a minute or two, and then they would just simply cry, boo-hoo. Let's see what happens next.
The Grinch, with his Grinch feet, ice cold in the snow, stood puzzling and puzzling. How could it be so? It came without ribbons. It came without tags. It came without packages, boxes, or bags. He puzzled and puzzled till his puzzle of a saw. Then the Grinch thought of something he hadn't before. Maybe Christmas, he thought, doesn't come from a store. Maybe Christmas, perhaps, means a little bit more. What happened then? Well, in Whoville, they say that the Grinch's small heart grew three sizes that day. And then the true meaning of Christmas came through, and the Grinch found the strength of 10 Grinches plus two.
The eyes of the Grinch changed. Seuss does something here that I think is really interesting. He helps us understand that there is something that's happened in the life of the Grinch that was conveyed through his eyes. His eyes turned from red to blue. And if you watch the whole that whole section of the movie, which was on TV last night, by the way, that I watched again, you'll see that his eyes go from red to blue, then back to red, then back to blue again. As he's holding on to the sleigh before it's going careening over the cliff, his eyes goes from red to blue, back to red, and then back to blue. I think he gives us an image of many of our faith journeys. That our faith journey is not a fluid motion from where we began to heaven, but rather there's setbacks, and there's times that we are awakened to God's presence, and then there's times that we are cold to God's presence as his eyes turn red. It carried me back to one of the miracles of Jesus when he opened the eyes of one of the individuals that was blind. He made the paste, and the man's eyes were open, and Jesus asked him and said, "What do you see?" He said, "I see men, but they look like trees walking." What did he do next? He did a reapplication and opened his eyes again. It took two times for the man actually to receive his full sight. So what happens when we begin to see not just with our physical eyes, but what happens when we begin to see and to perceive through the eyes of our heart, as Paul writes in 2 Corinthians, that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened to behold the glory of God in the face of Christ Jesus. Well, let's take a look at that. If you go online and look, and I'm sure you've seen these come by on your Facebook feed, or you've just seen maybe in different media, but all over the World Wide Web, there are videos of individuals who hear for the first time, or they're able to see for the first time. The most recent one that comes to my mind is a young man who is colorblind, and he has special glasses, and he's able to see color for the first time. It is amazing. It's very stirring to see that. But imagine seeing for the first time your spouse, or your mother, or your father, or a child. It would have to be a stirring experience. Imagine the first light dawning on creation there in Genesis as God's light. It was not the light as we think of as the moon and the stars and the sun shining, but right, because that was only done in the fourth day. The first light that illuminated the earth was the light of God's presence. It's thought to be the Shekinah glory. And it was only after that God created the sun and the stars and the moons. So the very first light that the chaotic place of this world before creation, the first light to lay its shadows upon the ground was the light of the presence of God. John tells us that Jesus is the light that came into the world to give light to all humankind, to all men, to all women. So somehow God in his great design has caused there to be that within us that responds somehow to his presence, that the light comes on. There's this sudden awareness of God within our lives, his presence with us. We saw that in the first clip of the Grinch, as he puzzled because the Who did not wake up crying boo-hoo, but they woke up and began to sing the wonder of Christmas. He couldn't figure that out because he had taken all of the gifts and the trees and the stockings and the food, and yet they were singing. And he puzzled and he puzzled, until he realized that maybe Christmas doesn't come from a store. Maybe Christmas means a little bit more. His eyes changed. There was something that God was doing. There was a reality and an awareness that came to him then that he had not had before. We perceive light which comes from the glory of God as we gaze upon the face of Christ Jesus. That awakening that we experience in those moments of awareness is not our light. It's the light of the presence of Christ, illuminating the darkness and giving us understanding that we might see and that we might perceive, that we might have an awareness of him. But something else happens too, and we see this in the clip that we just saw. So what else happens when we begin to perceive the light from the eyes of our heart? The other thing that happens is that we perceive a power that is beyond human strength. We perceive a power for living that is beyond human strength. Remember at the end toward the end of the clip, he is holding on to the sleigh, keeping it from going over the cliff. And I have wrestled with what happens in that moment. So he's holding on to the sleigh, and that's when his heart grows three sizes larger. How many of you noticed the tree on the left-hand side as you're going out of the vestibule? Notice the heart, the different size hearts. That's what that's supposed to represent. It's our hearts growing, expanding. But what happened at that moment? Troy and I were talking about it before the worship service. His idea was that it was at that moment of holding on to the sleigh that had all of the gifts and the food from the people of Whoville, was that was the Grinch's moment of repentance, that he had taken these things from them. And he was holding on to those and wanting to return them. That's one great, great idea. What I thought about too was that maybe it was in that moment that he was holding on to those gifts, thinking that they were going to bring him the joy that the people of Whoville had. And in that moment of holding on, it was a crisis moment when he realized that they're not going to bring me the joy that I expect. That maybe it was that moment for him that he realized that for him too, Christmas is not found in a store. But maybe it means just a little bit more. And again, remember seeing that's when his eyes turned blue again. But notice the sequence of events there. The first time his eyes turned blue, but this time his heart was enlarged, and then his eyes changed. I think that's critical. I think that's really important for us. Do we simply see with our natural eyes, or is God opening our hearts to see through the eyes of our heart, and then allowing that knowledge and understanding of the greatness and the glory of God in the person of Jesus Christ, who has come to live and abide within you and within me, to pardon, to redeem, to restore, and to be with us forever? Does that knowledge that comes deep within our heart, does it then begin to flow out from us? That it is then expressed in our eyes, in our words, in our behaviors, in our interactions with others. Because there we see a dramatic change in the Grinch. Also notice there at the end, as he lifts up the sleigh over his head, remember what he said? That he received the power of 10 Grinches plus 2. 12. Again, does this relate back to our scriptures? How many times is the number 12 used throughout the Bible? Probably at least a dozen. 12 sons of Jacob, 12 tribes of Israel, the 12 stones that are the foundation of the wall of the kingdom of heaven. And the list goes on and on. Are there things that we're holding on to that in our holding on to them, that God is somehow stirring within us that these things are not bringing us joy? These things are not going to bring us life. We hold on to things like hurt and our own personal image, our persona, our own sense of power, our possessions, and the fact that we want to control things. And maybe God is saying, that is not where life is found. And maybe it's in holding on to those that God begins to change our hearts. It was in that moment that I believe that the Grinch's understanding, I call it a conversion moment. Conversion. Not something we hear a lot about in the church anymore. Conversion, I think, is that moment when our understanding of God begins to transform our hearts. And in transforming and changing our hearts, it changes our behaviors. We become more forgiving of others. We become more patient with those that try our patience. We become more accepting of those who are different than yourself. We begin to see life with a new value, with a new attitude, with a new disposition. That comes about when we begin to perceive not just with our eyes and with our head, but when we begin to see through the eyes of our heart. So when we begin to perceive with eyes of our heart, we receive a power that's beyond human strength. But we also receive power that transforms hatred into love. One of the last scenes of the movie is the Grinch, after he has returned all the gifts, the last scene is the Grinch sitting at the end of the table with the Who all beside him, and he's carving the roast beast and passing it down. The Grinch's heart was so transformed that the very people that he had such disdain for, he now sat with them and served them. The very ones that he hated, he now sat and enjoyed community with them. 1 John chapter 2:9, John writes there, "If anyone claims to be in the light but hates his brother or sister, he is still in the darkness." If anyone claims to be in the light but hates a brother or sister, they're still in darkness. No matter how much I might want to claim that I'm walking in the light, if I have hatred and disdain for someone, how can the love of Christ abide within me? When in reality, when we hate others, maybe sitting around Christmas, the dinner table, it might be those around the table that you have every good reason in the world to hate. We have every good reason. The way they have treated our loved one or whatever they might have done, we have every good reason that we would want to hate them. In reality, our hatred of others and their sin brings about sin within us, even as we pretend to be righteous. Because Paul writes in Corinthians that love keeps no record of wrong, it's patient, it's long-suffering, it extends grace. Not that we condone bad behavior, but we love those individuals even in the place that they are, just as Christ has loved us, where we have been and where we are. So I think the real hero of the story is somebody that we've not even talked about. Who was that? Cindy Lou Who. Because isn't that basically what she did? Quietly, silently, in the background. Maybe that's what we're called to do. Sometimes it's easier to love people from a distance, isn't it, than really up close. Maybe sometimes we have to allow, kind of be like the tide. We move in for a little while, not move in, but we come close for a little while, and then we have to draw back for a little while. Never removing our love for them, but maybe just giving us some space to care for our own hearts and souls. There is a wonderful old Jewish rabbinic parable. I probably shared it with you before. And he asked his students one day, he said, "How can you know when night has ended and a new day has dawned, and when there is enough light to see?" His students heard the question and pondered it. And hoping to really impress their teacher, one responded, "When there is enough light that you can distinguish plants, that one is a briar and another is a grapevine." The wise teacher said, "That's a good answer, but that's not correct." Another one responded, "When there's enough light that you can look in a distance and distinguish between a dog and a wolf." Again, he acknowledged the wisdom in that answer, but it was not correct. And then he gave him this answer. He said, you know that night has ended and a new day has come when there's enough light in you that you're able to see in the face of a stranger, your own brother or sister. Only then will you know that night has ended and that the day has come. Lord, may you grant us grace to behold you with the eyes of our heart, not just the eyes of our heads. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks for your presence with us. Thank you, Father, for the working of your grace within us. And we thank you, Father, for the mystery of your Spirit within us. And those moments in which you give us a type of awakening, an awareness that our eyes are open and we're able to see and perceive something that we've not seen before. Father, we thank you for the mystery of your presence within us, and that is not our human ability and wisdom, but rather it's an expression of your glory, the glory of Christ Jesus illuminating our hearts and minds. And Lord, we thank you that is an invitation. An invitation to move deeper, to call upon you to open not just our physical eyes, not just our intellect, but to open the eyes of our hearts, and there perceive the glory of your Son, born in a manger, high and exalted upon a cross, and ascended. And who will return again? Father, transform our hearts, we pray. In the name of your Son, Christ our Lord.